Hey guys, Hafodet here, back with a lot more input lag tests. We have new controllers, mice, and an analog keyboard. On top of that, a new test of the Steam controller configuration in Rocket League with shocking results. Let's get started. Before I get into the data, I need to quickly point out that the testing methodology has been discussed in previous videos, and I will provide further information at the end. Most people just want to take a look at the numbers, and that's fine. But if you end up having some kind of question or criticism, then watch this video till the end. And do the same for the previous controller lag test, where half the numbers come from. As always, the full data is in a spreadsheet in the video description. Okay, enough of that. Here are the graphs. At the left, you see the input device. Whenever the device has multiple connection methods that perform significantly different, the specific connection is denoted. I'm also testing both button press response as well as analog sticks, and this is also noted on the left if there was a significant performance difference. The mice I've tested this time are the ASUS ROG Gladius, the SteelSeries Rival 310, and the Logitech G305. The tested latencies are for clicks, as I don't have a reliable way to test sensor lag. The devices are all 1000 Hz, and they have a very consistent input lag, which is helpful for any game that requires timing. Even the wireless G305 did excellent in this regard, despite not being the fastest overall. By far the most requested controller from my previous video was the Nintendo Switch Pro. However, I had some issues with this controller. Wired, it wouldn't connect to my PC at all unless I was using the Steam controller configuration. Wireless, it was working fine though. The results weren't particularly impressive though. The controller sends signals at a rate of exactly 65 Hz, which results in suboptimal input lag and consistency numbers. Wired with legacy Steam config, it did even worse, although these numbers should be taken with a grain of salt as it's not native usage. Then we have the SteelSeries Stratus XL, which looks like it may be great sitting near the top, but that is only the button press lag while using a wired connection. The analog stick has a much higher lag, and this discrepancy is something you'll probably need a while to get used to. The wireless numbers are all not that great, and that's a shame because this controller is not intended for wired use. It only has a USB connection intended for firmware updates, which is inside the battery slots, and I had to use X360CE to even make it work wired. Although it's not unusable, this controller cannot be recommended for competitive use with significantly better options available. Next up, the Cooler Master MK850 is an analog keyboard. That means it can sense how far you press down the buttons, which allows for smooth control as with an analog stick. Unfortunately, the update rate fluctuates between 43 and 50 Hz, which makes it the most inconsistent input device tested so far. I have only tested the analog delay, but that is what makes this keyboard interesting, and the competitive advantage analog can provide is being diminished when you are at an input lag disadvantage. The keyboard can fill an entire video on its own though, so I'm going to leave it at this for now. The last new entry is the DualShock 4 version 1, and there is a lot I have to say about this. In the previous video, I had already tested the V2 of the DS4, and got a very good result on wireless, but a worse average input lag in wired use by comparison. I don't want to repeat myself on everything I've said in that video, so if you're specifically interested in the DS4, then make sure to watch the other video too. I got a ton of comments about that part though. Of course, multiple accusations of my results being wrong because they thought wireless can't be faster. That is a pretty nonsensical argument. Wireless isn't inherently slower in any way. Differences are usually from energy saving measures, specific protocols that aren't required for wired, or when some signals don't arrive at the destination, so the receiver has to wait for the next one. Wireless is usually less consistent because of that, and that was no different for the DS4. Now, if you still don't believe this, I'm not actually the only person to have tested the DS4. In one of the tests, which didn't quite have the sample size and accuracy of mine, the difference was 7 to 10 milliseconds. The other experiment found the exact same results as mine, down to a tenth of a millisecond. The first experiment was done with the PlayStation. If you scour the internet, you might also find some tests of the V1, and you might see that it isn't any slower wired than wireless. This is, however, just because the V1 only uses the wired connection to charge and still sends the information wireless to the PlayStation. The V1 is simply slightly worse than the V2, and if you connect it to a PC over USB, it will also be even worse there. How do you know which generation you have? If it was bought after the PlayStation 4 Pro came out, then it's probably second gen. If you have a default controller, just look at the touchpad. If it is completely opaque and you can't see any light from the LED shine through it, then you have a version 1 controller. But this may not be true for special editions. It is really a shame that Sony didn't just set a polling rate of 1000Hz over USB, as the controller seems to be performing just as fast as wireless then, and with better consistency, according to the tests from WebD. If anyone knows how to overclock a controller on Windows, then please share. I tried the common tool that people use for mice, but it just doesn't seem to work with the controllers. Time to cover the Steam controller configuration again. If you remember, in the previous controller video, I measured an input lag increase of 1 millisecond when using the Steam configuration, which isn't bad, but it's unnecessary considering that all other configuration programs I've tested caused no measurable delay. Since then, something has changed. Psyonix added the option for native support for the Steam controller configuration. This means that instead of just setting up your controller to map to Xbox 360 buttons and then bind those buttons, you can now bind actions like drive forward directly in the configuration. With that, I thought that the 1 millisecond may be gone. But now I'm wishing it was just the 1 millisecond delay. First, my tests wouldn't run at all, because it was just so inconsistent that it couldn't run my usual 5 plus button presses a second. Running the tests really slowly worked, but the results are shockingly bad. With my new monitor and processor, the baseline latency I can achieve is just 3.2 milliseconds on average, and a variance so low that every single measurement in the entire test is between 2.5 and 5.1 milliseconds. Turning the Steam controller configuration on, the average is now 31 milliseconds, with results being between 6 and 58 milliseconds. I went back and forth so many times to make sure that I changed absolutely nothing else in the test, but the result was always the same. The Steam controller configuration, in its current state, should not be used for Rocket League. In fact, this setup is significantly more inconsistent than me, based on the measurements done in my video on input consistency. If I were to try and shoot the ball with perfect timing, I would fail more often because of Steam than because of my own inability. Can you still use the old system? Well, yes, you can. After several people told me that they were still using Steam config just fine, Alpaca found that the old system is the same as always. If you load an old profile, like the ones from my Deadzone video, or the ones labeled Legacy, you will not run into these issues. To make sure that you're not using the new system, just open your bindings. With the new system, it will throw you straight to the Steam config. I often get asked which controller I recommend. I don't really like answering that question as long as there is not a clear winner in objective terms. After all, these tests only take a look at input lag and the consistency. If your goal is to compete at the highest level, then I'd actively discourage you from using the SteelSeries Stratus XL or the Nintendo Switch Pro Controller. Especially the latter could become a limiting factor in timing-sensitive situations. However, especially if you're going pro, then you also have to consider how much time you spend with your controller. An uncomfortable grip is going to be awful for you in the long run. This is something that you can only really test yourself. As to why I'm not testing controller X or Y, it's probably because it's expensive. If anyone or a group of people is willing to donate the price of a controller, I will test it. I've tried contacting the companies creating them, but only one even bothered to reply at all. Last but not least, I promised more information on the testing, so here is a step-by-step description of how I test a device. First, I open up the device to see where I have pins that I can connect cables to. I check which pins belong to analog sticks and buttons. Then I connect my Arduino to the pins of the axis that I want to test. The Arduino will change the voltage at will during the experiment. The controller is fundamentally just a device that measures those signals, and rather than creating them by moving the analog stick, I create them artificially. Second, I close everything running on my PC, open a custom map in Rocket League, lower the graphics settings to the minimum, and cap the frame rate at 1000. Afterwards, I set custom camera settings with infinite swivel speed and teleport myself into a specific spot on the map. In this spot, when you swivel the camera left, a part of the screen will turn completely black, which will be used as the measuring spot. Which brings me back to the Arduino. It has another connection to a contraption with a lot of photodiodes. These diodes allow me to measure brightness, and they will be placed in front of the screen. The reason I use so many is to span the entire vertical size of the monitor. This allows the reduction of monitor scanout related inconsistency and therefore more accurate judgment of the controller consistency. After setting the proper binding on the controller, the test can start. The Arduino will change the voltage on the controller and start an internal timer. This timer will be stopped when any of the photodiodes in front of the screen detects a significant decrease in brightness. This process will be repeated at least 1000 times at an interval with pseudo-random variation. The Arduino will show a summary of the information on a display, but also send every single measurement with microsecond accuracy back to the PC for further analysis. Most of the time, I save these two files, and later add them to the spreadsheet you can find in the description. Some additional notes. Anytime I start a testing session, I retest the default setup to make sure there is no difference. Things I've tried for the first videos. I used three different Bluetooth dongles. There was no measurable difference in lag between any of them, only the distance at which they would connect to the controllers. I used the one with the strongest signal for every Bluetooth test since. I also tried testing how different distances between controller and dongle affects lag. There was no significant difference between 0 and 3 meters for most controllers. The Xbox One controller on Bluetooth had a few more inputs dropped, but nothing interesting beyond that happened, so I've not been testing that since. For the normal tests, the controller is always placed right next to the dongle. Different buttons or analog sticks on the same controller. None of the controllers ever showed a difference in input lag between different buttons. I've not verified this on every single controller tested, but most. To make sure the inputs don't line up with specific timings within a frame, I tried unlocking and relocking the frame rate after every single measurement. Again, there was no difference. Taking thousands of samples per experiment allows me to minimize the impact of randomness on the sampling process. With a 95% confidence interval, you'd expect 1 out of 20 controllers to have a true input lag that is outside of this interval, which is not acceptable. Despite the sample count, you shouldn't expect 0.1 millisecond accuracy. On the least consistent devices, like the MK850, the variance is so high that a 99.7% confidence interval equates to plus minus 0.4 milliseconds after 2000 measurements. On top of that, with my old processor, I'd have up to 0.3 milliseconds of variance based on whatever Windows wanted to do in the background. With my new processor, this problem seems to have resolved though. Anyway, if I left any questions open, then feel free to ask them in the comments, or better, in my Discord. I'm always happy to discuss as long as I feel like the person has at least watched the video. Which you just did, to the end, so thanks for that. Shout out to my patrons, without whom I wouldn't be able to buy these controllers for testing. If you want to stay up to date, follow me on Twitter or join my Discord, and I'll see you soon for the next video.